So Jessamyn, I don't want to say I don't think you need an introduction, except I think your fame precedes you. Jessamyn has been helping people to become more technically literate for a long time now, and she's going to give us the benefit of some of her experience. So we really appreciate it, and thanks.
Great, thanks for having me. Can we turn these lights back on? I know it's kind of hot, you don't have your gun yet, so if anybody wants to take a nap, I won't feel wet. There's handouts on the back table. If anybody did have the internet, my slides and links to a lot of the stuff that I'm talking about are there. So it's kind of like what we would call an e-handout back when we were prefacing everything. So just think of it as a website with links to the stuff that I'm going to be talking about. And that includes all the slides and links to stuff and this handout, which basically when they asked me to come here and explain what you guys were doing, which is super exciting, and I really wish the state of Vermont would ever do anything like this at all. I said, you know, I'm happy to come and I love Nebraska and everything else, but what I would do is I would just print out this handout and just give it to everybody and basically just read it, because Phil Agree is was a professor in California. He was known for doing this mailing list in California back in 1996 when we were communicating via the electronic mail called Red Rock Eater Digest. And it was stuff that other people had written and stuff that he was written and sent it to friends of his. And he was very good at putting in very plain talk some fairly sophisticated ideas, both about physics and other things that he did for his job, but also stuff like this. I don't know if you saw it, you can grab it later on your way out. It's on the internet also. But basically some of the things that we take for granted when we're working with novice users, and I don't know about you guys, but I've kind of had computers since there were computers. Not because I'm a super gadget freak, but because my father worked in technology. So my father worked in technology, so we had computers in the home. Which doesn't really, I didn't have all computers as a kid, but they were just around, and the big thing was they were normal. It was normal to have a computer. It was normal to have a connection to another computer. It was normal to have a network. None of that I really thought that much about. I didn't do computers. I didn't do computers in college. But then when I went to library school, which was in 1993, which was when computers were just starting to be a thing people thought about, suddenly the fact that computers were normal for me separated me from a lot of my peers who were going to library school, for whom not only computers weren't normal, but they were potentially a horrible threat and everything was wrong with the profession, which, you know, fine, it's fine. Like, one of my favorite things about the Obama administration is he's introduced this is a topic on which reasonable people can disagree. Like, I think there are threats to our traditional way of life from computers. I also think there's untold, unforeseen opportunities most of the time, and both of those things can exist simultaneously. So the fact that I was comfortable with computers and enjoyed using them and loved the library and the public space that supports and all that stuff meant that it was kind of natural for me to do sort of technology, education, and education as part of what I did. And over time, I went to library school in Seattle. And I was doing kind of my first email classes in 1999, and we were teaching people how to get on Yahoo, I think, Excite, whatever, Hotmail, whatever the free email program was at the time. And I sort of figured the way everything was going to work in my life was that I was going to teach everyone how to get email, me and my colleagues, and that everyone was going to get email, and then we were going to move on and teach people how to do more sophisticated things. And that didn't happen for a number of reasons. One, I moved to the East Coast, which lags behind the West Coast in technological innovation. I don't know how the Midwest sort of factors into it. I assume you're kind of like us in that way. I moved to a place that was more rural, so definitely a lot less uptake in various things, which is the good news, bad news, right? Like, I have farmers in my town. They are awesome. It is great to eat food that the people in your community make. However, sometimes that can go hand in hand with, we do things the way we've always done it, which means the fax machine is fine, or the post. I'm a big fan of post. So, long story short, I'm still teaching my first email classes, which now is almost 20 years later. And email's changed, and the internet has changed, but the fact that there's still a big group of people who still don't have that information, and who now, kind of as Americans, need it, whereas they didn't before. When I was giving somebody an email address in 1996, they were cutting edge, kind of. I mean, they didn't even think that because they knew other people who had had email addresses since before that. But nowadays, if you're getting an email address, you're kind of a late adopter with all the kind of baggage that comes along with that, which is challenging and, in fact, one of the biggest struggles I think of doing technology instruction nowadays. The computer stuff is not to be glib, but kind of the same. But the cultural shift is very, very different. And that's a lot of what I'm going to be talking about, because I think anybody who knows how to use a computer has at least some of the requisite skills to be able to pass on that information. But understanding what people are bringing to the table is complex, and I think a little, maybe not what people are expecting. So with that said, that's what I'm going to be talking about. And so the other thing is digital literacy itself, like feeling digital literate, feeling digitally literate, feeling capable with your literacy stuff. I was really naive in library school, and I was like, we're just going to get there, and then we're all going to together go somewhere else. And, you know, I had to kind of calm down personally, but also for my work, and realize it's a lot more of kind of a journey. And partly the reason that's important is because the technology changes. And one of the things that we see all the time teaching people, you know, I use Gmail now. Gmail users in the room? Have you all gotten forced to use the new Compose window? Did it make you crazy? No? See? That's a good attitude. Me? I have a terrible attitude because I'm like, why do they keep changing these things? And yet, like, I'm a computer lady and I teach people how to use computers, and I should be able, of all people, to handle the fact that I'm using something that is free. I'm using it specifically because it allows Google to send advertisements to me and a bunch of other things. But I use it, it's important to me, and the world will change around me as I am going on this journey, and I need to be ready for that. Our students are going to need to be ready for that, and we're going to need to be setting expectations for that that are sort of appropriate. So the good news and bad news is, I think anyone who can use a computer can teach people how to use a computer, which is cool. The bad news is a lot of the money that's available, and it's one of the things I love about this program, but a lot of the money that's available, you see people who get a lot of money, and then what they're going to do is build another website that's going to teach novice users how to use computers. And the whole point, obviously, it's like having to take off your glasses to fix your glasses. Like, if you can't use the computer already, you're not going to be able to use the computer to teach you to use the computer. With some caveats, and I'll talk about that a little bit. So the good news is there's lots of people who will take your money to sell you computer information. The bad news is that doesn't always help, and for a lot of the people we're going to be working with, that doesn't is not helpful for them specifically. And it kind of makes you look like you don't know what they want. So this model, which I love, is like we provide the resources through a website for you all who know how to use a website, and we're here to help you use it, and then you can do the one-on-one, face-to-face, we're going to be together with this, with live human beings who may not be entirely comfortable being given a URL and said, good luck. So I think that's great. So I'm going to sort of break down what some of the hurdles are, and then towards the end I'm going to talk about some of the sort of techniques and whatever that have worked for me. This is not going to be so much how to teach, but the lay of the land of novice users and technology instruction generally, and I hope that's okay. And I'm around all day too, so I'll be here sitting in the back being like, speak up or whatever when you guys are doing your thing. So getting started, one of the things about libraries, of course, that we know is you're working with people who are local, right? I think what people would love is for there to be a website and everybody on the planet could go to the website and they'd all learn the same things because we all need the same whatever. totally not true. There's not a lot of good top-down solutions for technology instruction. We had the Gates Foundation for a long time. Did they come through Nebraska? Did they plow through Nebraska and give you guys computers and then say good luck? Because that's what they did in Vermont. And some of our libraries, our teeny-weeny libraries, are still using the computers that the Gates Foundation gave them. Yes, yes, okay. I thought it was just us. Like, I love Vermont so much, and I would never want to be anywhere else. But our local control of libraries means that we have some little independent libraries that just kind of do things their own way. And I'm always like, but they're like, we don't have any money. So we use the computers from 8, 9, 10 years ago, and if they still work, we're still using them. Good. Glad to have those guys. And so that's great. Yay, Gates Foundation. I appreciate their efforts. But it was a partial solution because, in many ways, there was not the human solution that came along. The trainers blew in and blew out. And the portal websites, like I've said, you know, click here to get on the internet and learn everything, don't really help the needs we divide it. And so one of the things that I think is an important strategy, which you guys do in Nebraska in a good way, is making sure you're collecting the data on these kinds of things, because nothing helps get more people interested in what you're doing than explaining how many people it's helping, than explaining how many people need this help, explaining whatever your little numbers are. We got 6 computers and we had 270 people using them in the last month. People understand, or they think they understand, their numbers, and they respond to that in a way that they don't always respond to, you know, we got this 80-year-old lady an email account, and as much as that's awesome and it plays really good on the radio, you kind of need both things to approach people to explain why this is important. So one of the reasons you guys have this kind of awesome grant is because your people put together compelling stories but also compelling data to make that work. And so one of the things moving forward that you're going to be able to do is not just do the work that you're doing, but make a case for why this work is important moving forward, which is very exciting. I'm very excited for it. All my pictures, by the way, are Flickr Creative Commons, and they're linked, the sources are linked. Every time I make my boyfriend look at my slides, and I'm like, how are they? He gets caught up. I love that guy with the books. That's all I want to be doing. And I'm like, this is about computers. He's like, he should be using a computer. But the illustration here is, in America, if you don't know how to read, for example, there's literacy programs that'll help you learn how to read. And they're usually small scale, but like kind of top down in the country, but done locally on kind of a small scale. You can get someone usually to teach you for free, not always. If you don't know how to drive in the United States, you can take a driving class, you can pay a person who will teach you how to drive, or more likely, you'll get your friend to take you to the Walmart parking lot. The big thing about both of these skills and the reason that I bring them both up is if you're an American who doesn't know how to drive or you don't know how to read, you're kind of aware that there's a thing that you can't do that other people can do that gets them places that you can't go, either figuratively or literally. You're aware that there's a social cost to not being able to do those things. Even if, I mean, my sister has epilepsy and she couldn't drive for a real long time, and like, it's not her fault. She just couldn't, and so she was aware that she had to move to a place with public transportation or do the other things you have to do in order to get where you need to go. No big deal, she was fine. You know, people who read, little babies, none of them can read. Educate them, and it's fine. One of the things that I think is a real problem with novice users in technology is that they're not aware of the world through the screen. And in fact, they think they're aware of the world through the screen because they've seen the internet on TV, you know, it's all like this. Like, very exciting, the internet on television. Or it's all like this, I've come for your children now, you know, and I'm wearing a t-shirt that says creep. like, you see very kind of, like everything on TV, which you know about after a while, it's a very kind of two-dimensional, stereotypical thing. It's either like scary news, the internet, where the creeps hang out, or selling you something, the internet, where the party is that you're not invited to, or something like that. And you're not really sure. You're like, well, I don't have any children, and I don't want to go to that party, so I guess I don't need the internet. And I think for a lot of people, they're not really aware of all the other junk that you can get I mean, the example that I always use in my little town, we have a little department store in my little town, which is great. It's great having a little department store. And you can go there and buy ink for your printer, which is great. And if everybody knows about printer ink, like printers are basically free so that they can sell you very expensive printer ink, which costs more than gasoline, ounce per ounce. Which, whatever, it's fine. That's how the marketplace works, right? But, so if you're in my town and you're not on the internet, you go to Bellmaine's, who appreciates your business, and you buy your printer ink from there, and it costs a fortune. And so your whole view of printing, the world, whatever, is printer ink is expensive, printing is precious, and et cetera, et cetera. I buy my printer ink from some, I'm not even sure where they are, company on the internet that sells them in bulk, and it's really cheap, and it turns out it's pretty much the same printer ink, although sometimes it's not. But for me, prints are cheap. They are free. They are inexpensive. The printer ink comes to my door. I don't even need to go outside in the winter. You guys have winter, right? We have winter, too. It's smaller winter, but it's still winter. And, yeah, when I got on the highway and saw that big gate that they close, apparently, when you're not allowed on the highway in the winter, it's not just for cows, right? It's for you. I was like, this is serious. Like, we have winter, but we don't have gates. Keep you off the highway. But so our two views of the world are completely different. We view printing completely differently just because of our access to resources. And they don't even, and I feel like it's like some invisible secret garden of cheap printer ink. But that's basically what the internet is to me. You know, I can shop for things, I can interact with people, I can do a whole bunch of stuff. And so people aren't aware of what they're missing out on. And in fact, their incorrect assumptions, see, you know, stolen children, party. A lot of people stay offline because they believe things that aren't true. No big deal. Like, they're not stupid. They just have misunderstandings based on bad information. So the reason we know this, actually, is that the Internal Revenue Service, everybody's favorite federal organization, they have a mandate to, and there's a link to this study if you're nerdy about studies. They have a mandate to get, I think their goal was like 80% of people e-filing by 2015? See, this is when I like quote real numbers and I realize I don't remember them. 2015, I think. But anyhow, they want you to file your taxes online. The reason they want you to file your taxes online is that they save $2 for every single one of you guys that doesn't mail in a paper form. And I sometimes mail in the paper form because I just, like, I trust, like, the computer with my information. I just kind of like knowing they have it by putting it in the mail. I'm like, I hate myself because it costs the IRS $2. But they, it's my little way of fighting that. But they, so they really want to save this money. Plus, the error count way, way down, right? Because in the past, you send them your form, and then they've either put it through a computer or pay some person with a terrible job to type these numbers in. You type one number wrong, you've ruined somebody's life, or made their life, right? I don't know. My sister got a couch delivered once, and the person had to type the information from the order form, and instead of typing the number for brown, they typed the number for seafoam green, and the couch guys came, and they're like, and she was like, oh my God! Like, but it was just, you know, it's an error. Errors totally happen, but they affect people's lives. And my sister did grow up and get over it. But the IRS would like you to type your own numbers, basically. So, to this end, they did a big study of what is keeping these people from e-filing. Because one of the things the IRS can't do is they can't make you. They're not allowed to force you to get on the internet to file your taxes. They would really love to force you to get on the internet, but they can't. Number one, because they're not allowed to compete with TurboTax and all those other people, laws, rules. But number two, they just can't make you. They're not allowed to have a law that says Americans need to use the internet. You'll notice states have done that. Like in Nebraska, do you have to file your state income taxes? Do you have to do it online?
No, you can call and request them to send
a paper form.
Yeah.
But otherwise?
Otherwise, they're not even available. You can't pick them up to post them.
Yeah,
they're starting to do that in Vermont. Everybody's like losing their minds, like kicking and screaming though, because they're, you know, they're uncomfortable. And like taxes make them uncomfortable, and computers make them uncomfortable. So it's this dual uncomfortableness of Every time I'm like with a group of people too, I always ask like, what's the thing that made your people get on the internet? Like when I talk to a group in Maine, like the thing that you now have to do online that you didn't have to do before, when I talked to a group in Maine, they were like, oh, moose licenses. Like, if you want to get a license to shoot a moose in Maine, you have to get it on the internet. You don't want to use the internet? I don't care. You get no moose.
Job applications.
Yeah. That's the killer. Unemployment in Vermont, same thing.
They forced us in Nebraska to do it online, and people are freaking out.
And they're happy, right?
Isn't it also disability, too?
The worst. And on the one hand, I super sympathize for those people because they're already frustrated and dealing with a frustrated situation, and then they're also dealing with a computer. On the other hand, I sympathize for our government workers who we have to also pay for who don't want to just type everybody's stuff. I mean, I wish we were in a future where everybody was comfortable using this. So the IRS did a big study. What's everyone's problem? Like, why can't we get people e-filing? Basically, and it's not what's everyone's problem. The IRS is very chill about this. And they studied basically non-adopters and did a big study. So it's not just like Pew where they call 1,000 people on the phone and do a survey and they're like, we know this about the world. I mean, I love Pew, but they do little surveys. This was a big kind of more wide-ranging survey, and they found four different types of people, basically. One, don't have a computer. Don't have it. Okay. Two, internet. No internet. Okay, all right. Three, don't care about the internet. shut up about the internet, basically. Seriously, like, the internet has nothing that interests me was kind of one of the answers that people had, which, like, I mean, I take that as, like, challenge accepted. Like, I bet I can find something on the internet that you're interested in. You just haven't been on the right internet. But the third group, and these were about 25%-ish. The last group was basically afraid, or they needed help, or they needed a person to help them. And now, let's be clear, that's their impression. They maybe, you know, if you sat them down, maybe they don't need a person, they know how to do stuff just right, but they're uncomfortable. And that discomfort, regardless of whether it's real, imagined, who knows? You know, a lot of people I see in classes, you know, they had a partner, their partner died, their partner ran the checkbook and the computer, and they're kind of fighting it out with the checkbook, and they're like, no, just forget it, the computer, like, I won't do it. And those people are real, and the thing that's so interesting about them in my world of, like, you know, like, I'm not checking my email while I'm talking to you guys, that's difficult for me, is that there's tons of them. You know, the IRS found that this was 20%-ish of the people, why won't you e-file? I'm afraid. And so a lot of what you guys are going to be working with is not just, oh, computers, you said. How do they work? Like, they're not just like interested, excited, oh, I just never got around to it. People, there are people who have concerns. They are frightened. They are nervous. Or they're angry at the computer. I had one lady who came to drop in time, and I'll talk a little bit about drop in time in a second. She came to drop in time, she had a laptop, it was her laptop, we're trying to use it, and she's having trouble with this, that, or the other, and every time something doesn't do the right thing, which happens to me, she was always like super angry, and I was just, you know, worried and making sure I knew where my panic button was, but it turns out, we talk a little bit, a lot of what I do is talk in and a little type in. And we talk a little bit, it turns out this was her ex-husband's computer, who met his new girlfriend somewhere on the internet. And she didn't know enough about computers to even know what that meant, but the computer was essentially hers now, and as well, her enemy. And so a lot of what we did, she's been coming to drop in time for like 7 years, and she's now got her own ultra netbook, and she uses it for work, and has an iPod, and, you know, but it took a long time. But a lot of what we had to do was kind of talk through, and I'm not a very good therapist, like, I'm kind of like, wow, huh? But making sure that she didn't project feelings that weren't appropriate onto the computer, which had done nothing to her. But we did have to kind of talk through it, like, computer's not mad at you, it's a robot. Robots aren't mad. I'm sorry you're mad, computer's not mad. So, talking a little bit more about that. And so the IRS's big takeaway is the technology, actually what they found, is secondary to the motivating behavior of getting people online. That the computer part is not the hard part anymore for most people. If we can get a person a computer, hey, we got them in libraries. If we can get them the internet, we have that too. Then what we need to worry about is motivating these people. So your job is kind of maybe different from what you thought, which is like the good news, bad news. Like, I'm cheery and I like talking to people. You know, hey, just think of the computer as. But if all you want to do is teach a person how to use email and you wind up with these digressions about their ex-boyfriend, one of the things you'll be learning is how to manage people's expectations, because that's going to be a big part of the people you wind up seeing in what you do. So backing it up a little bit, one of the things about the tech literacy problem also, we talk a lot in rural areas where I am about like institutionalized poverty, right? So poverty isn't just like, I don't have any money right now. Poverty is like, and my family doesn't have any money, my friends don't have any money, and we've been living this way for a really long time, and we're having a hard time seeing a way to do anything but this. And that's the problem. The problem is, if it was just someone's poor, you're like, here's $20, now you're not poor, problem solved. But with institutionalized poverty, of course, you have to address the systems that are broken and how you fix them. So technology illiteracy is kind of the same thing. You can't just throw money at it and have it miraculously go away, because the big problem is there's a lot of confounding factors. There's a lot of people who you may look at and you're like, why don't you know how to use a computer? Like, you should. Like, it's easy to kind of blame the people who are stuck in it, you know, which is hard to kind of work your way around it. And a lot of the people now who don't know how to use computers, the wacky thing about them is that they also don't know people who use computers. Like, they're stuck in a group of technologically illiterate people, and there may be a vast amount of overlap with institutionalized poverty at the same time. But one of the things the Pew studies found is that these people have multiple challenges. Either they have low education, they may be disabled. Using a computer when you're disabled, there's tons of assistive technology, which is terrific if you know about it, which many people don't. They may not speak English very well. The internet is great with English and a little more challenging in other languages. I'm just trying to figure out how to take the little N with the tilde over it. Like, I know how to do almost everything on this, and I can't type an accented E without Googling how to type an accent. In fact, I just Googled the word cafe, and then I copied the letter. Which works, but like, I don't know how to do that, and if Spanish or French was my language, upgrade. So not surprising, people are having these challenges. Or they're, you know, an ethnic minority in their area, they've been persecuted for some reason, they're in a divided family. There's all sorts of challenges, but usually they co-present, as we like to say, with technological literacy. So there's a lot of debate about what's working nowadays for teaching technology. The debate continues because we don't have enough data, which is why I'm very excited about this program, because numbers are really helpful, instead of just being like, everybody's off the internet, we don't know why, because they don't answer our online survey. But in short, if you don't know how to use a computer and it's 2013, there is probably a reason that isn't just never got around to it. In fact, you may think the answer is never got around to it, but really it's probably not. You know, if you don't drive an automobile now, that's a conscious choice that normal people can make. But there's probably a reason, and it's worth understanding that reason to help those people. You know, I'm not judging, I'm just saying, really, you get around by a unicycle? That's just for no reason. Okay, then. So it might be a good reason, might be what you consider a bad reason, but it's worth sort of knowing what that is, and that'll help you help the person. So in the United States, this is one of my favorite, considering Loom County used to have this fake computer that they made up that Oliver, the little nerdy kid, would have, and it had feet, and it would walk around, and they made fake ads for this fake computer that was too smart and would follow Oliver around. And at any rate, in the United States, if you don't adopt technology, there's very few things that will force you online, which we talked about a little bit before. Some government forms, some things you might want. And job applications are weird because they fall into the kind of you want them, need them, you know, depending on where you are. But like things like unemployment, you know, that's the government just being like, you can't get on the internet, kind of tough. And I think that puts people in a difficult place. I also understand where it comes from because, you know, like the IRS, like we all pay them. So most of the people that I see getting online for the first time this year, last year, 2 years ago, whatever, is either because they're forced to through not really awesome circumstances. I'm unemployed, I just got divorced, I gotta look up my healthcare information online, etc. Or good things, like I got grandkids, they say they're on Facebook, what do I do? And that's fun and also kind of challenging because teaching somebody how to get on Facebook to look at the grandkids, there's a whole lot of steps to that. Like, so have you ever used a mouse before? Now, what we used to do back in the day, teaching people how to use computers, was we'd take them apart and be like, actually, you think the screen is the computer, but really the computer lives in this box. Let's open it up. And people would be like, and we're like, no, no, I'm really smart with computers. I know what this part does. People would be like, and they would just never come back, and we'd be like, I don't understand. I'm clearly smart with computers. And they're like, grandchildren. Where are the grandchildren? I'm sitting here like this until you show me grandchildren. And so part of, you know, one of my steps, one of the things I talk about is early on having successes with your students, even if it just means, look, I'm gonna show you your grandkids, and then we're gonna back it up, and we're gonna step forward. Or I'm gonna show you my grandkids, or whatever, and then we're gonna step it forward. Or I'm gonna show you my dog, and you can imagine your grandchildren, and then you gotta be careful with this. But something like that. So you show them Facebook, you don't make them, this is a modem, which is a thing we used to use back when your computer would make a telephone call. The fact that you're bright with computers and understand this stuff, sometimes it becomes really challenging to not want to share that, because I'm very excited that I understand how HTML works, but it doesn't matter to somebody using Facebook. I'll show off at home with my friends. I developed a new way to do unordered lists, which I did for my notes, and I'm very excited about it, but you don't care. Like, it doesn't, it's not part of this conversation. So, sometimes people in my town, mailing lists for groups. There's a community garden. There's a mailing list with 8 people. There's an 80-year-old gentleman named Fred. And he comes in to drop in time when he wants to add a person to the mailing list or take a person off the mailing list. Very serious business, this 8-person mailing list. But like, he's learning to do it himself. He's happy. You know, he could have an assistant. He could tell me to do it. Fred's wife could be like, Fred, I can't watch you anymore. But he's got a level of competency that allows him to run the thing he really wants to run, which is the garden. And we're all sort of the better for it in the community. I don't know about you guys in natural disasters, but like in Vermont, many of our people got online for the first time after Hurricane Irene. And we saw a lot of it in New Jersey and New York with people getting online with Hurricane Sandy. We kind of had Hurricane Sandy, but we really, Hurricane Irene, like, the roads went away in a lot of Vermont. FEMA, our Federal Emergency Management Agency in Vermont, had their servers in a ground floor room in a building on a floodplain.
No.
So, what they wound up doing, because whatever, I mean, that was a bad decision, and it's kind of a funny joke, but they're still FEMA, and so what they wound up doing was getting a Facebook page immediately and posting PDFs of all their updates. So it was a little awkward because literally their website was just down because they were hosting it themselves, which is actually not a terrible idea. And it's easy to morning after quarterback everybody's stupid technology decisions. But they wound up going to Facebook, and what that meant was the people who were just accessing the internet through their phone could actually interact with FEMA, either talking to them about there was a big problem, read the updates. Our state library could push those updates out to people. It was a remarkably flexible response to the whole thing. And for a lot of people who didn't have electricity at home but could come to a library or another place to charge their telephone, that turned out to be a really good way to get people in touch. And I use that as an example where people are like, nothing there for me. And I'm like, as long as your power's on and you can talk to your neighbors and the roads go to your town and you don't need medicine, but maybe. So for a lot of people, I actually talk about it as like an emergency preparedness thing. I don't really care if you want to use it. You're allowed to hate it. I hate Facebook. I use it all the time because that's where my friends are. Like, it's just, you don't have to love it. Like, I think a lot of people look at people like me, and in fact, even people like us, as true believers. Like, you just drank the Kool-Aid, and I heard that's from here.
Yes.
Do you guys have like a big statue or something that I can go see?
Later? That's Hastings.
Where's Hastings?
Hastings out by me.
It's over 2 hours.
2+ hours.
Over 2 hours.
Yeah. West, by like a couple hours.
Right. Yeah.
Hour and a half? Yeah. Hour and a half.
Yeah. Hour and a half.
Alright. But they think that you're some like zealot who is like, woo, computers, I am brainwashed into thinking they make my life better. And it's like, no, I'm kind of practical about it. They solve problems for me. Your people are going to want people to solve problems for them. In Vermont, and you probably get this too, I think there's a lot of people who think they're keeping it real by not using technology. We all argue about how much we don't care about our cell phones. And I have a lot of friends without cell phones, which is kind of great because it means we don't have cell phones as part of our, you know, social interactions. It's bad when I need to contact them for any reason. But there is a sense in which people think they're harkening back to an earlier time by not using technology, and I often ask them how they feel about smallpox. Because, you know, there's all sorts of other things that the simpler times had that were not so great. Lack of access to technology is a good and bad news thing, as opposed to smallpox, which is a bad news thing. But same kind of thing. Or they mistrust it, or they mistrust us, which one of the things that I think is great about you guys too, people already kind of know you, hopefully, and so they can trust where the message is coming from. It's not coming from, who's your big telco here? Like ours is Verizon and Fairpoint.
We have a lot of little telcos.
Oh, really? Yeah. Yeah. If I was going to get DSL in my home when I lived in Lincoln.
Windstream.
But like anytime those people tell you a thing, you're always kind of like, I'm not really sure, because they're also a company who wants to sell you things. But you know, if somebody in your library is like, no, I really think this will help you for a measured small amount, good news. So this is where I work. I just work in a computer lab with ancient computers that run Windows XP, and shut up.
You got about 200 more days of support.
You think we need support?
More security updates.
Yeah, that's a problem, isn't it? Well, I don't know, actually, because I'm going back. I start again in 2 weeks, and I was telling Michael before. The report is all the computers are broken. Like, that's how my boss, who herself is not particularly tech literate, gets information across to me, who is tech literate. And so I had to just leave it because I didn't want to spend, you know, 10 minutes being, but I am curious what she means. When you say all 150 computers are broken, does it mean that their whole guts are hanging out? Does it mean the network isn't working? Does it mean you turn them on and nothing happens? If you try turning it off, you're turning it on again? Basically what I do, I have a couple jobs, but my main sort of computer teacher job is, we have a vocational high school in my town, so it's 11th and 12th grade for kids who are learning trades, basically. 8 sending towns send kids there, and then the kids go home at 2:30, and there's a building full of current computers and a fairly speedy network that was just being empty. So I started out there as a Vista volunteer 8 years ago, and have gradually worked it into a job. 2 days a week, I'm the lady, like just 3 to 6, I sit in a room. You got a question, you come in and ask. I also teach classes. Drop-in time is not a class. It's a different thing. And people have to have a question. If they don't have a question, I'm not going to, like, what do you want to learn? Oh, I don't know. Well, come back when you want to, or, you know, I'll give you some suggestions. Would you like to look at pictures of puppies on the internet? Would you like to read our state governor's news reports? Like, usually it's one of those things, like, when I would say I was bored and my mom would be like, clean your room, and I was like, oh, just remember what I want to do. similar kind of thing. So Randolph, where I live, is about 4,000 people, and people come from 8 or 10 tinier towns. And, you know, we sit in the classroom, there's wireless, people bring their laptops. Up until about 2 years ago, people were using the desktop machines. All of a sudden, it seemed like people had laptops, people had Kindles. I had to learn how to use a Kindle. I didn't know anything about Kindles. So I was like, let's look on the website. Help us. People had netbooks. People had all sorts of crazy stuff. iPods, knockoff iPods. So in addition to this job, I teach adult education classes. I fill in at my local public library. It's easy to say I'm a librarian, but most of the time, my job with the community is this job. I don't work at the public library. And then I run a big website called medfilter.com, which is the job that comes with health insurance, which is nice. So three categories. And so a lot of this is like basic skills, although people can ask any question they want. So if they're every now and again, actually not every now and again, every November, Diane Briggs comes in with a thumb drive with her access database full of addresses, and we remember again how to print mailing labels from them. Like, we never write it down some November. I always figure she's gonna stop asking and learn herself, but she forgets and I forget, and so then we do it again every November. So it's high tech and low tech. Right now, this is my friend Marion. Marion's in her late 70s, she uses Facebook. She's kind of interested in Facebook. I like Marion because she's like excited about the internet and doesn't worry about messing stuff up, and so she's fun. She's also deaf, as a post, and so it's challenging to kind of, well, we've been trying to work with her to find like Bluetooth things. She can get like a Bluetooth thing that'll connect around her neck that connects to her hearing aids, that the computer can send the sound to a thing she wears that'll send it right to her. Because we were watching Downton Abbey together, and it's really difficult to watch television with somebody who doesn't hear very well and doesn't have any assistive technology because it's extremely loud and you can't talk to each other and whatever. So this little Bluetooth thing solved the problem for her, but it was a little computery. And so she was a little hesitant at first, and so now that works for her, which is kind of cool. So she's on Facebook, and then this is Joyce behind her. Joyce is also in her 70s, really into the garden club. Mostly, I think, comes to drop-in time because she wants to talk. Hey, how's it going, kind of thing. But also learns a thing. Joyce is not on Facebook, but is curious about Facebook, and I think she actually enjoys this situation, looking over Marion's shoulder as Marion kind of, than she would having me be like, no, click the thing, the other thing. No, it's a menu. The little triangle is a menu. It's like, I'm pretty nice. But she knows I know all the stuff. And so we're not usually on a journey of exploration together. And so one of the things that I do the most in what I do, and it seems really weird to say it, is what I call benign neglect. Like, we'll get people started on a thing, and then I'll kind of wander off and be a little bit in my own world for a bit, and then I'll come back again. How are we doing? And most people will kind of, and I'll always tell them, you can't break it. Like, you cannot break it. You can't break it. You could try and break it, and you couldn't break it. So don't even think you can break it. And so I encourage them to explore. 75% of my students will. 25% will be sitting exactly where I left them when I walked in. But, like, that's how it works, you know? And those people are real people who need to learn how to use a computer, and so they may need some more structured, you know, steps that are shorter, closer together than other people. So benign neglect. And you guys probably know I wrote this book, but I also made this website, and if you pop out the related websites, you'll get a list of a lot of the training sites that I use. I mean, the handouts you guys got, which I also got, are terrific. They have a lot of links to stuff that I'm either already using or am interested in, a couple things that I hadn't learned before. You can never underestimate the importance of handouts, because, I mean, like today, people talk, and you remember what you remember, and you remember what you wrote down. But having a piece of paper later to be like, oh, right, very helpful. And people really like it. The other thing I use a lot in drop-in time is I have like a bookshelf of dummies guides, which is weird, right? Because dummies guides are kind of like, hey, you would like this. So you got to really finesse explaining why you're handing a thing that says for dummies to somebody. But the books are really good. Like, they have really helpful, clear instructions. And the best thing they have, which I think a lot of people really grab onto, is they've got an index. An alphabetical list of stuff, which is why everybody is mad that the yellow pages don't exist anymore, where they can find the things that they know what they're called. And so we just have a shelf of books there that people can look at, and they can interlibrary loan them from their library. Like, they can go to the library and get them if they want, but these are just free and they can look at them. Because because I think a lot of people, if you tell them, go to the library and get one of them dummy books. They're not going to do that. Why would they do that? I wouldn't do that. But if they can see them and see that they're helpful, that can sort of be really helpful. So the book's got a companion website. If you're good at stealing things from the internet, the PDF is always zipping around the dark nets somewhere. I gave another talk on like fair use and sort of open source stuff, and I was like Googling my book to try and like download the ebook version from my library, and I found it was actually easier to steal my own book in PDF format from the internet than it was to check it out by overdraft. Surprise? But so this page has a lot of resources, and also you can totally get in touch with me. So this was a very long, rambling introduction to what's more sort of specific stuff. So specific things you need to think about. Many of these are going to be second knowledge for you, but it's worth kind of bullet pointing them out. Understanding your local situation and being a local advocate. I think all of us think the library is mostly awesome. I think in our communities there are a lot of people who share that view, and then the people who don't share that view for whatever reason, those people may change their mind if they find out libraries are doing computer stuff, but they may not, and so it's worth being able to get that message across to people who may not already be sold on the library, which is challenging. And so every context is really different, right? Is your community highly connected? Not really connected. Older? Younger? Big local employer? No big local employer? Tight-knit? Commuter community? Older? Your approaches are going to vary depending on who your people are, and that's totally appropriate and a good idea. You may find that you've got lots of teenagers who don't know anything about the internet, and approaching them is actually a better way to talk ultimately to their parents than talking to parents and being like, so you don't know the internet. I know the internet, shut up. So for instance, this is kind of a messy map. I live here in Randolph. The darker the color, this is the middle of Vermont, the darker the color, the more connected people live there. So the kind of dark brownish, almost blackish, that's where 90 to 100% of the people in the community have access to the internet. Broadband, when I say internet in this case. And as you get lighter, you get less and less. When you get down to basically the sort of tan parts here, that's 15% or less of the people in the community are connected to the internet. So I live on a little island of internet in a vast desert of nothing. That's changing a little bit. In fact, we have these adorable front page pictures in the paper of the guy with the draft horses bringing the internet cable through the mountains. But I'm not lying. Like, we have mountains and rivers. Like, we have many geographical reasons why we don't have more and better internet. Makes it harder to get satellite, makes it harder to get cables, you know, terrestrial stuff that stays in place. And so they're working on it. This is actually 2 years old, so it may actually be a little bit different now. But it's pretty, And so William Gibson's big quote is like, the future's already here, it's just not evenly distributed. Like, I live in the future, I have a little pocket computer where I can look something up. I have a blue dot that makes me never lost anywhere I am in America. Like, that's a real privilege. That's an amazing thing. And I pay some money for it, but not what you would think you would pay for that. And so one of the things I find with this institutionalized divide thing is it can be invisible to people that there's people in your community or right next door who do not have this. Like, a stupid example, but like my boyfriend doesn't have GPS in his car. Doesn't have a smartphone. Whatever. We still date. But but if we have to meet somewhere, he has to print a map, and I can't just be like, oh man, place is closed, you know, key in these new numbers. I have to, you know, if we're both on the way, I have to sort of talk to him and be like, okay, you gotta turn the thing on the thing and then the other thing on the thing, and I can just, you know, retool and get there. It's not a huge deal. It's not a real big inconvenience. He doesn't need a GPS. I'm not like, I don't think he's a dummy because he doesn't have it, but I have this privilege that he doesn't have by benefit of understanding this little machine that you wouldn't think was the case. And so we're still in America looking at 35% of people who don't have broadband at home, 32, 30. That number, which you would think would be going like this, is like going like this. Like, more and more people are getting broadband through their phones, but fewer and fewer people are getting any other internet at their home. So those numbers are kind of weird, and then we're still looking at 18% of Americans who have no broadband at home at all, including their phones. And so when I talk to people who live in big cities about this, they're like, nah, there's no one who isn't on the internet. Like, my neighbors aren't on the internet. Like, my friends don't have cell phones. Like, this is really true, but it's kind of invisible because, especially with social networking, again, which I love, you see the people who are networked. You don't see the people who aren't networked, or you only see the aren't networked people when they're in the library on the Facebook. And so you don't twig into the fact that there's tons and tons of people like that. And I don't mean you guys, because I think you guys are on top of it, but your other sort of people in your communities may not know, and they may need that information. So part of the job is just telling people stories. So you guys all know what Nebraska looks like. This is the Nebraska broadband map where the colors, so red, those people have DSL. Purple, those people have fiber. Access to, not necessarily have it. Orange is cable, which I guess is not very popular except along the highways. And then tan, nothing. Those people have nothing. Which, I mean, I understand there's not a ton of people there.
What'd you say?
It's all cows.
No people up there.
And a whole bunch of really offended people that you've forgotten about.
No. There are no people up there.
Yeah. Why it has, they have nothing, right? But before people can wind up learning about the technology, they need to figure out how to get connected in the first place. And then, you know, Michael put this together, I think. This is you. I don't know.
John.
Okay,
yeah.
It was nice,
but anyway.
But basically saying like, hey, did you know that 82% of libraries are providing the only free access to internet in your communities? Big deal. And this is in Nebraska. It's an infographic that's up on the website. But that helps explain why you're doing what you're doing and why it's you who are doing what you're doing. Can't we just pay someone to, not exactly. And then my favorite thing, American Libraries, this just because I'm like a nerd, but like every year when the report comes out, it has a lot of information, not just about the individual states, but about how the states are lining up with other states. Does Nebraska have a rivalry with any other state? Because like Vermont and New Hampshire, everyone, they like fight because they're different. And so everyone's like, New Hampshire's really good. And everyone's like, you're a bunch of libertarians. And like, you're a bunch of anarchists. And Nebraska's big enough it doesn't fight. No, you're not.
Oklahoma. We fight amongst ourselves.
Right. Well, you can use these statistics to figure out sort of how your stuff is going versus other stuff. They collect a lot of information about libraries, about how libraries are using their technologies and about what they have, and so you can figure out how what you're offering measures up, whether it's better, worse, or whatever. This is how I know that the things I say about the state of Vermont are true, because the numbers support me. And so as much as I love Vermont and I would never live anywhere else, we could be doing better in certain library-related topics according to math. Not me, because I'm crabby, math. And this is sort of helpful. So, you know, as an example, the end of everything is a little thought bubble thing. So you guys, we have 270 public libraries in the state trying to teach everyone how to use computers, start from this message, and we need your help. So moving forward, you want to, of course, form partnerships both with the things you're doing, but also see who else is doing what you're doing. Because it's too easy, I think, sometimes to want everyone to come to you. And when I first started talking about teaching technology in sort of a programmatic way, one of the things that I have to say that's a little, I don't know, edgy is not the right word, but like, we maybe can't teach everybody everything, and you have to figure out where you're gonna draw your lines and set expectations. And this is much, much easier to do when you know who the other people are in your community who can sort of fill in the gaps and fill in the blanks. It used to be that anybody who had a computer problem would wind up at the library, which is great, but some of the things they would sometimes need would be things that we weren't prepared or set up to be able to help them with. But if we could appropriately refer them, we didn't feel like we had to just be like, I guess you'll just never learn it, which, you know, sort of nobody wants. But not everybody needs one-on-one attention at the moment. What else is available in the region? And I found that libraries in my neck of the woods, who are the most effective at this are often the ones who are good at being like, we do this, other people do this, other people do this, let's figure out where you need to be for what you need. So like, for instance, AARP does classes in Omaha as a really basic kind of thing. If you were in the Omaha area, maybe someone needs a 9-week, $15 class at AARP and not 2 hours of your time every week when they could be doing something else. And maybe they don't. Like, it's entirely possible that this isn't correct. It's just good to know what your options are. Like the drop-in time, we have a great relationship with the library, so that when people are showing up more than once or twice, being like, I really need someone to handhold me through this, the librarians don't have to be like, I don't have time, you drive me crazy. They can just be like, Jessamyn would love to help you with this. You know, and then they say a little thank you prayer and be like, I don't have time, this person drives me crazy. But because there's a person that can help them, it's appropriate of them to send them to me, not just, I don't want to deal with this, even though they're not set up. So like local tutors in more populated areas, Craigslist a lot of times has computer tutors. One of the things that we don't do at all that you may see people asking for is come to my house. And we had to draw a line really early that was like, like, come to the house, I'm sorry. Like, it doesn't work. In fact, if somebody wants to write another big grant to get somebody to drive around in a little truck and come to people's houses, huge unmet need. But the problem is, once you touch somebody's computer, then you become the person who last touched the computer, and then it started doing that thing. And now you gotta come back. And so, difficult. So, Craigslist, senior centers, whatever. The good news is people are coming to the library first. Terrific. The next good news is you can appropriately triage those people and see if what they need to do is be with you or not. The other thing is, don't assume everybody is broke. Though many people are, and that's totally okay, but like this was a thing, a program the Geek Squad was doing in conjunction with AARP. Like, oh, buy a computer, and if you chip in an extra $100 or whatever, you get unlimited. Dude comes to your house, sets up your computer, tech support, you can call them on the phone. Maybe not for everybody, but I think we also assume, I often assume, that the people who I'm helping don't have the resources to get other kinds of help, and I'm not always correct in that assumption. I think it's a good place to start, but it is worth being like, you know, if you can pay someone to do some of this stuff, that might be a more effective way of getting your problem dealt with. Not always. But like, for instance, if a computer's got a warranty, I had some kid come in, and they had some horrible problem with the computer, and we were troubleshooting, I'm like, I have no idea why it's doing that thing. And ultimately, it turned out, after much, he's like, well, I just got it like 30 days ago. I was like, oh, it's still under warranty. Like, get out of here, call them, they fix it. I don't fix it when it's under warranty, necessarily. And so, figuring out that kind of assessment, important. One of the other things that I do is when I'm looking at resources online, found a good website, found a good handout, found a good thing. This was in, not around here, St. Paul. I'm like, oh, that's a nice website. Oh, that's set up really nice. Who gives them money? And how is that project funded? And do they fund other projects? And do they have handouts and other material that I can have? So this is like a really nice set of classes and a nice website with a state literacy council funded by the America Connects Consortium that I don't really know anything about, but I could click through and learn more about it and figure out if they were a good fit or if they did anything sort of local with me. A couple other examples of people who are doing really good stuff. I think these people were the model, this is in the UK. I think these people were the model for some of the ad council things that we were looking at this morning. Similar looking website, but basically they are computer centers. In the UK, they have computer centers that are different from libraries. And they have computer centers that basically you can get a computer buddy, where you just meet with a person from your community who maybe knows a little bit more about technology than you do, who isn't even a teacher, and they make a date to just hang out on a library computer, or in this case, an online center computer, an hour a week. It's one of those things where it actually helps with, they call these people, they call this issue, we call it the digital divide, they talk about digital exclusion. Like their whole issue is you're being kept from the world of online that you need to be connected to, so let's figure out how to keep you from being excluded. which I actually find to be very helpful from kind of a phraseology perspective. And it also solves some other social problems because it gets other people out of the house, talking to each other, hanging out with each other. I mean, I don't know about you guys, but especially in wintertime, we have a lot of seniors who could get a little bit more socialization in the wintertime because they're a little nervous about going out and they don't go out at night and a whole bunch of other stuff, and having a little thing to do. Drop-in time is a little thing to do. Going to the library is a little thing to do. Super helpful. And so asking yourself, who else should we be working with? Who else is out there and what are they doing? This is my favorite section, which is talking about thievery. The greatest thing about being in the library is that it's okay that we give things away to people for free, but also that if we take other people's things, they are unlikely to come after us. And a lot of this stuff, handouts and stuff like that, people tend to not mind if you want to take them. So maybe there isn't anything nearby, or it's not good, or it's too expensive. And you guys are making your own classes, and you've got a whole bunch of handouts that are available, and you're going to learn to make new handouts. But one of the things that we probably don't need is yet another Teach the Novices website. Although, man, I looked at that PLA, the one that you showed up earlier, really nice. Normally because they're not that good. I was looking at it on my phone, like it looks good on your phone, too. That never happens. Beautiful website. And so making handouts or stealing some things, and here are some ideas that other people are doing that I have found useful and stealable for my own stuff. So this is a terrible picture because I wasn't planning on putting it up here. This is Surprise, Arizona. Arizona's a really interesting state in a lot of ways because their libraries have a lot of funding and their schools don't, for whatever reason. And I don't know why. And so they have a lot of stuff going on at libraries, which is exciting. There's typos in this too, I didn't make this. But basically they have a thing that's up at all the reference desks that says, hey, do you need help with your thing? Come to the special help thing that's on a special day at a special time, and the special person will help you with it.
The expert.
And, I know. I'm a spell expert. How do you do it? But the font is so unreadable anyhow, it almost doesn't matter. But so the thing that I like about this program is threefold. One, hey, we know how to help you with computery things. Two, we care about that, and so we've got a guy or a lady to help. Three, it's on Thursdays, which means if you come in on Wednesday and you're like, where are my Kindle, and we're all really busy, we can be like, hey, come in tomorrow, and we'll totally set you up with Kevin. But you can also then, appropriately, you'll hear me just hammer, set expectations that we have a special time for doing this, which means everything isn't, I need this now. Well, we have jobs, and we need to appropriately fit you into where we're doing what we're doing. So it's a great program, and it's also really good at having set times and places to do things. I mean, here's my feeling. I'm a librarian, and I would like to give everything away to everybody all the time, and I think the library should be open 24 hours a day, and everyone should have the key. But the reasons that is not realistic are the same ones, which is why you shouldn't drop everything at the reference desk and help a person who can't get their thing to do the thing. I mean, if your stuff is broken, like I can't get on the computer you told me to use because it is broken, it's one thing. If their stuff is broken, or even if they're confused, it's totally okay to help them at an appropriate time. Remember how I said everybody who isn't on a computer isn't on a computer for a reason? Sometimes those reasons are people don't prioritize whatever the stuff is, and they're not prioritizing your time, and it's totally okay. I'm here telling you, I'll write you a note to be like, hey, Kevin's here tomorrow. Can it wait till tomorrow? If not, we'll try some other things. So it's a good way to say we don't do that right now. Nashville, Tennessee. Around holiday time, they make this amazing display, which is basically like, oh, are you getting somebody a gadget? Did you get a gadget? Because I know for a lot of us, I got a ukulele for my birthday. And like, I don't play music. I just don't know how. And I'm a little bad with the hands. Like, I have one hand that's really good and one hand that I don't know what this hand is. And you have to use both to play a ukulele. My boyfriend's a musician, and he's like, now we can play music together. And I'm like, you have given me a terrible project, and I hate you. It's got a happy ending. I learned to play the damn thing. He got an accordion, and so.
That's a happy ending?
But what it, But I have these eye-opening realizations where I'm like, oh my gosh, thank you so much for getting me a terrible project. And I think that's what a lot of people, when I'm like, Grandma, it's a Kindle! And you don't understand why they're not delighted. And so having things that go along with it that aren't just how to use it, because you know how Amazon is, they're like, plug it in and start shopping.
Yeah.
And they don't tell you, like, you can get thousands of books for free. You know, you don't have to give all your personal details over to Amazon if you don't want to. Like, if you care about your privacy, you might want to read some stuff. And so you might want to go to somebody that you trust, like the library. These things are not only instructions on how to get started and how to get ebooks from the library, but they're also like, and we have classes, you know, like, come here, we'll help you. Because gift-giving time and gift-receiving time is always a stressful time for a number of reasons. Having ways to make the library help you with that, super good. And they're going to come in anyhow. It's good if you have kind of a measured approach and response as opposed to like, oh, it's the wave of Kindles. Remember when tax time used to be that way? People were like, forms. Now it's like Kindle. It's very simple. Here's another one that I love. From this just local, Cranston, Rhode Island. Edgar is the librarian there. And if you're nerding around in the genealogy books, like you do, you get to the end of the thing, you're like, hey, wait a second. And they have a little thing that's kind of bookend, looks like a little book, and they're like, by the way, we have a database that you can look stuff up on, and we have an information sheet at the reference desk, and if you're interested in this kind of thing, you might be interested in that. So I'm all about finding ways to make technology a genuine option for people. Genealogists are happier with the internet. It's just true. It's just true. If they don't know about the internet, you're gonna blow their mind. However, they're not quite sure that's true, and so you have to find a way to, like, kind of nudge it over. Like, maybe you just want to look at the thing, you know? Because otherwise, you're like, oh, let's go search the census on the internet. That's a pain. But like, being like, oh, we have this little database. One of the things I didn't know about novice users when I started, and still have a hard time believing, they don't know what a database is at all. Like, the word database is just blah, 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 ginger to them. And so trying to sort of start with, we've got databases, not helpful. Feels like it would be helpful. I feel like that's English. But a lot of them are like, you have, to them it sounds like, I said, we have spreadsheets. And that doesn't sound like fun at all. So trying to figure out ways to make that happen. So I kind of love this. It's just in the stacks, just a little thing. It's got little handouts in it. And it's kind of a trick. Back to other things you can steal. Mousercise, if you know anything about me personally, you know that Mousercise is my favorite website on the internet. Seriously, I like it better than Google. You should never teach someone how to use a mouse again. You should take them to Mousercise, which is basically like this. It's got a, I mean, you show them the mouse. Hey, it's a mouse. I know it's stupid. There's two buttons, but you use this one all the time. You never use this one. Rollerball, don't touch it for now. Put them down. If their fingers work, now we have people who have like shaky hands and a whole bunch of other reasons that that might not be great for them, and that's a different thing. People with worky fingers, you can click through. It's got like 30 pages. Click here. Now click over here. Now click here. Now you've got to scroll to get to this button. Click this. Click this number. See how it's got an underline? It's the nicest thing. It's written in very straightforward English. Doesn't use a bunch of funny words. Not a very exciting website, but it's also not a very exciting website. And you can go through, and if I sit people down with this, about 15 minutes, not that long, they can usually get through it themselves. And at the end, there's like a little confetti thing, and they're like, wait a minute. You can print out a certificate. Awesome. But also, by the end of it, they've learned 20 things about mousing that they might only kind of learn over time happenstancely, and they have kind of an idea of what the mouse is. I actually interviewed the guy who made up Mousercise for the Palm Beach County Library in Florida. Like, why did you do this wonderful thing? And he's just like some nerdy IT guy who knew how to build a website. Like he didn't go on to greater things. Like this, he just, I mean, he's still working in libraries, but like this was the pinnacle of like his amazing user. Like, he's just an IT guy who does stuff. I bet he can fix our library though. But this website is perfect. But like that kind of thing, having a link to that or showing people how to use that makes people feel taken care of, saves you 15 minutes of time, and it works. So it's not like you're like, I'm just gonna let the computer run mind the baby. It's actually solving the problem. Other websites that are really good, Milwaukee Public Library. They teach classes. Every single handout that Milwaukee Public Library uses for every single class is available on the internet. I love this. Like, they have a class on calculator. Like, I'd love to be a fly on the wall in that class because clearly people take it and clearly they get a lot out of it. Calculator. Like, it's genius. And so they only let you take a class once a month. One of the things that I found and that you will probably also find is that people come back. And you gotta figure out what you wanna do if people come back, if you've got limits to classes and whatever. You know, I had one lady who came to my basic email class, like an email class that was so basic we taught it with, like on the chalkboard. This is what a CC line. Let's just talk about it for a while. I'm not gonna type, we're just gonna talk. Talk about email. And she'd come back every month and be like, you know, every month I get a little bit more out of it. Great. We had a lot of space, so it was fine. But you may need to sort of think about that. So in the meantime, if you're teaching class on any of these, take these handouts. Or at least look at them and see if they work for you and if you could use them or repurpose them for what you're doing. Every minute you spend typing up a new handout is probably time you could spend
teaching a class.
I was more thinking watching Downton Abbey, but similar, similar, the same. But I was thinking, like, what do I like to do that I would, you know, making dinner, who knows? So asking yourself, what are other people doing that works? Can we do it? Setting the expectations for everybody. The other thing is, I don't know how many of you guys are going to be doing any teaching versus kind of managing a bunch of teachers. But one of the things that's really challenging is to remember that the digitally divided among us, or the digitally excluded or whatever, at least where I am, can often include the people who work in our libraries and the people who do the things. When I originally started doing my Vista job, they were like, train the trainer. You'll take novice people who have never used a computer before and you'll teach them how to teach other people to use a computer. I was like, I'll try. And that wasn't a realistic goal. I mean, I think the buddy system works really well, but it's really different just barely knowing how to do a thing and being able to help a person who really doesn't know, who might be frustrated or angry or upset or whatever, to do that thing. So I'm in favor of training the trainer programs. I think they're good ideas. I think buddy systems work really well. I don't think you can train everybody up to be a really good teacher, which is okay. But you need to be realistic about what the expectations are, both for the people you're teaching, but also for you know, your staff or your students or your interns that are going to be a part of this. There may be stuff they don't know. Do they need to learn it? Is that a lot of the websites that are made for tentative technology users, not specifically to teach technology, but like the unemployment sites and the Moose license site or whatever the sites are that are sometimes their first experiences are awful. Like, I'm not mad. They're just bad. Like, you can totally say, this is not a very good website without insulting somebody because there is such a thing as good design. So it's okay to say, this is hard for people to use, therefore my tentative technology users are so. It's fine. It's totally appropriate to say. I think sometimes we don't wanna, we just wanna be nice and be like, oh, good effort, ALA. But like, their website's really hard to use. I said it. But their website, they redesigned twice in the last 10 years. They broke every incoming link both times. That is not an actual thing that real people who design websites think is an acceptable outcome. And it might be one of those things that you're like, well, you know, we tried. And I think the we tried years are behind us in the last century. It's not enough to just get the stuff on the web and be like, it works. Now for drinks. You really have to make it look nice in order to be able to incent people, the motivation that we talked about before, to help people actually get to use them. But one of the things that actually is helpful is sometimes being like, it's just not a very good website, and we're gonna have to figure it out, but it isn't very good, and it's okay. It's not you, because people blame themselves. Why wouldn't they? I can't apply for a job at Home Depot. I must be incredibly stupid. And you're like, nope. Their website is horrible, and I'm sorry. But if you want to do that, let's... I mean, I think a lot of us have been there with people. And I think it's helpful to tell people the problems with them because they blame themselves. So you're just like, you know, they made some choices in how to make this look that were not good choices, or that were hard, or that weren't good for people without good vision. I work with a lot of seniors. You know, the website hates senior citizens. You would think it would love senior citizens. They have disposable income, they're motivated, they have years and years of fascinating stories and things that they've learned, but sometimes they've got slightly shaky hands, they can't see so well, and it's really hard for them, and it offends people. That is true, because that shouldn't have to be true. So, USA.gov, government made easy. So this is what I was gonna say before. Easy is one of those like touchy words for people, because easy is like, this website's easy. So easy even a monkey could use it, which means if you can't use it. So I try to prefer to say stuff like uncomplicated, or you know, this has a couple steps, and I think you know them all, but easy, touchy. And it's hard because you want to say, look, really, I think, because you want people to feel comfortable, you want to calm them down. But easy, So, you know, getting public services in the US, I don't love this website. It's hard, they alphabetize things. So what do you want from the United States? Do you want an auction? Do you want beach temperatures? How about some bankruptcy forms? Like, there's no, as opposed to the United Kingdom. How do you interact with the United Kingdom? Website? Laid out, what's popular, some photographs, big search, accessibility up in the corner, not bad. Like, all of a sudden, I feel a lot less stressed. I feel like I could get the things that I wanted from this website. This website, not so much. They don't think I'm very bright, and I'm not even sure what I want, and how come there's nothing that starts with K? I'm nervous. Seriously, nothing in the entire United States government that starts with K, really? So, Google has made some forays into this. This is a cute little website. It's linked on my page of links. It's called teachparentstech.org. It's basically a thing you fill in when your parents have told you they've gotten a computer. You're like, I'm stoked for you. You can click little boxes. It'll send them an email with links to very straightforward YouTube tutorials on very basic things. It's charming. I have no idea why it took off. It's one of 10 million websites that tries to do a thing. But and I link to on my list of links all the videos so you can click through them. I don't particularly learn super well from videos. They're too slow, you know? Hi, today we're gonna learn about, my life is bleeding away in 2 years. But some people really enjoy it. It's like television for them, and it's a good way for them to get information. And so this is sort of nice. Teach Parents Tech and the website, beautiful. You know what it does, you know how to use it. This is the sort of equivalent UK website to the Ad Council one here, pretty much. Go on, what do you need to learn? Fancy, good colors, not sure what's going on? Sign in, big buttons, not a lot of typing text for reading. One of the main things that we know about novice users and how they use computers, or the internet, they read top to bottom, left to right, every word on a page. I mean, I don't know about you guys, but for me, I'm like, where's the red button? Like, where's the next? Where's the submit? Where's the, I don't want to see this ad. Where's the thing? They are reading. And, you know, websites that want to sell you something will know that you're reading, and they'll put the button down here. Websites that are trying to help you out will put the button up here or up here. But it's sort of challenging. And so the UK has this approach, and they try to help people learn to go for the button. And banner blindness, like little advertisements. A lot of my students would be like, they look at their email, there's this picture of some lady, you know. Want to get ready for bathing suit weather? Why does Yahoo think I'm fat? They're just guessing. They don't know. But they assume those things are targeted to them. Why wouldn't they? They don't understand how the internet works. I can show them how to block advertising and do a whole bunch of other stuff, but, you know, awkward. And then this is a website similar called Internet Buttons. You can make a page for somebody that's got 5 buttons they can click, and you can put URLs behind them. Shaky hands, great for shaky handed people who are not so great maybe at typing in gmail.com, but they can click a big button that says Google. And you can set this up for people. The example they use is they make the Grandpa Simpson one. He goes to Springfield Isotopes and the Quickie Mart and History Pin and War Veterans United. You can even put a little picture of yourself down the bottom. I mean, you could do this at the library and be like, got trouble? Call the library. But for people who really needed a place to get started, a way to get started, beautiful, beautiful website. And they have a little helper thing that pops out and it explains how to set everything up. If you can move stuff around on an iPhone, you personally, you could set one of these up, and then all other people have to do is click. And then digitalliteracy.gov, which was on your handout. Great website for getting started, great website for seeing what other people are doing. Not super up to date. Sometimes it's a little full of like, we're Comcast and we're totally solving the digital divide. Do you guys have them as a cable company? Who's your cable company?
Time Warner.
Yes. I mean, they're all terrible, but like Time Warner, but you know how they all are like, we're totally solving the digital divide because we pay, charge you money to get on the internet. There is a lot of their things that they've built because, you know, as a result of lawsuits and other stuff, they have to help with stuff like this. But, you know, these websites, very good at getting started. And look at this. Like, how nice is this? The library. They know computers. They can help you with computers. And then, remember how I said I had a red circle in my presentation? So you're like, oh, that's awesome. I'm totally going to click on that. Hello.
Oh.
This may have, to be fair, have looked awesome in 1999. But so then people get stuck here, which is not terrific. I think, and
they start doing everything.
So they, exactly, so they type in every single box, and then, yeah.
And they're gonna look and go, what the heck is an FSCSID?
Do you know what that is? I don't know what that is. Does anyone here know what that is?
Yeah,
we know.
Oh, in the back.
We're bureaucrats, we know.
What is it?
The citizens don't know. It's your ID for what you like statistics.
Anyway.
Public library statistics.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah, so it's just a bummer. I mean, you know, I would like to use it to search for 8-bit bookmobiles, but it is just too bad. So, designy stuff. And the other thing we need to remember about designy stuff is big companies know how to use this to do what they want. So I have a Google account, and I have a big, huge problem with Google. I mean, I think I'm realistic about the extent to which they spy on me, but also create useful tools that I want. It's a trade-off I'm okay with. But what they really would like is my mobile phone number. I don't use it through my phone. I don't want them to have my mobile phone number for, I'm sure, irrational reasons. So I get to this page every now and again. Every now and again, they're like, Jessamyn, we noticed we don't have your phone number anymore. And I'm like, yeah, I don't feel like it. But if you're reading this page from top to bottom and from left to right, you get to the add phone number part first before you get to the click here blue link on black text that says click here to skip it. So our novice users think they're doing the right thing because they figured out how to fill in the box and click the button, and it's fine. Maybe you don't care that Google has a phone number. Like, that's an appropriate, that's a choice, and that's an okay choice to make, and yet,
it's also kind of tricky.
Yeah, people don't understand what their choices are, and it's hard, right? Because you might not know, and trying to figure out how to explain this without being too oogie boogie. Like, well, I guess it's true your account could get hijacked, but have a good password and know how to log out. But it becomes like a bigger question, you know, like if you have a child and you're like, what's that weird man doing on the street? And you're like, well, let's talk about, you know, the problem of homelessness in America. It becomes a really tricky thing to have to talk about. Another example, a Discover card. I have a Discover card, I use it as a credit card. It's fine. But every now and again, they want me to do something that I don't want to do. You want to transfer money? I don't, but, you know, there's 2 buttons. Get started, and no thanks. And if you're a novice internet user, you may not even know that's a link. But that's a button. And so people get cajoled down directions they might not want to go, even if they're savvy about this stuff, much less, you know, the crazy Bank of America emails that they get telling them, you know, your account might be compromised. I mean, it's so hard. We taught a class on eBay, one of the classes I taught in adult education. And the big deal was it became almost impossible to teach a class on eBay because we had to teach so much keep yourself safe, here's how to use PayPal, here's what you have to do and don't do, and then it made it really difficult to teach it in a short enough class because one part of the class was all about safety, which, you know, if you're already using it, maybe you know, but maybe you don't, and I feel it's kind of my responsibility. So back to the design stuff. I think a lot of people are like, it works! Upload it! And I think we can do better. I think we have been doing better. I mean, I think the websites you guys are dealing with for this project are really nice, and you're so lucky. But keeping on the forefront and working with the people you're working with, feel like, it's okay if you say the website isn't really good. Some people's website is not actually very good. That's okay. Like, you're not a traitor to librarians by saying, you know, ALA's website could be better. VLA's website could be better. And then I said that a lot, and then they put me in charge of it. And now people tell me it could be better. You know? And it could. So it's hard. Like, it's not an easy thing, but it's okay without, you're not being a jerk just by telling people their website could be better. So now just talking about people. Last section. Solving the real problem, people. Because a lot of times people will be like, I hear I have to get on Facebook. And it's like, well, do you want to get on Facebook? Like, what's the, well, my kids have grandkids and they put all the pictures on it, so I guess I have to because. Okay, well, do you want to, like, let me show you how you could get on Facebook to see these pictures, but you don't have to approve any friend requests. Let's show you how to not send out stuff to your email. Let's show you how to, you know, let's solve your problem for you, not for someone else who's like, you got to use it like this. Because a lot of people, again, the anxiety of not being online that has kept them offline also has given them some misapprehensions that they're not doing stuff right. Like, everybody's, like, I have a sister who's about my age. She doesn't use Facebook. She's a normal adult lady. And I trot her out a lot in classes because I'm like, it's not everybody my age is on Facebook. Most of them are, the people that I interact with. But it's a choice, and it's totally okay to not make that choice. So you should feel comfortable with whatever you decide. If you decide that, so I talk about sort of sample users a lot. And it's good to kind of model the kind of users you might have. So what are my users expecting? Do they expect a lot from me? Do they expect a little? How experienced are they? Do they have a lot of experience? Do they not have very much experience? So Kip up there, he doesn't really expect that much, and he's got a lot of experience. He's our dream, right? Radu down here expects a lot, not very good at it, challenging. And figuring out what people's level of knowledge is, usually you have to kind of ask a bunch of leading questions, figure out what's going on, and figuring out what their expectations are, often they will either tell you or tell you by their sort of absence of expectations, sort of what they need. So modeling patrons, and maybe thinking about this with your staff as well, because for people with very little computer experience, your computers that you're working with them on may be the only ones they know if they don't have a lot of experience, and that is a very different thing when you're explaining why it does a thing or why it doesn't do a thing. A lot of what people are learning interacting with operating systems, they're learning how to deal with metaphors. Like, it's not a real folder, it's kind of a pretend folder. And you can take a file, but it's not a real file, and stick it in the folder, sort of. And for a lot of people, that's totally new ground, very challenging, and some people just aren't good at that kind of stuff, and figuring that out while you're explaining a thing. Do they need hard metaphors for stuff, or can I talk about big ideas? And what are they hoping to sort of get out of this? And the other thing to remember is a lot of people, they show up. One of the things we learned in information school was that a lot of people don't even show up at the library until they've hit a wall. They have an information need, and they can't, and their friend doesn't know the answer, which is usually where they go first. So a lot of times they show up, and they're like, I'm going to be fired. You need to help me do the thing immediately. Chop, chop, or whatever. And you're like, what? Like, what's going on? But a lot of times people are stressed, unhappy, and angry, and part of what you wind up needing to do is find a way to diffuse the situation, which we do with angry patrons all the time, dealing with that situation first, and then figuring out, sorry, It's ruined! And then figuring out how to motivate people going forward. So I've got a couple more bulleted lists, and then we'll wrap up, have lunch. And like I said, I'm going to be around all day. But when you're doing your training specifically, and I was thinking about this when I was thinking about handouts, but I think it's true for outline and framing too, you want to make sure there's an objective that people can get to. Even if your students are slow, even if they're bad at this, even if they're mean, you want them to have some sort of success, a thing that works, a thing that goes their way in your class. And you may have to dial back what it turns out that can be, but you want to have a thing so that they feel like they have gotten slightly farther along that continuum than they were before. And this is challenging. Sometimes it's just like, way to go for coming in here. I know you didn't want to and this wasn't a thing, but I think, you know, keep coming back, that kind of thing. You want to have outlines that are fairly, like, you don't want to be like, this is the agenda, oh, it turns out everybody needs basic mouse skills and we'll back it up. But people want to know what to expect, and I think a lot of times they're afraid you're going to throw them in the deep end of the pool. So you guys all get on Facebook and I'm going to go check my email, and you're like, but I don't know how to do that. So being clear what's coming around the bend, having exercises. One of the things I talk to a lot of people about who just feel like they're never going to get it is a lot of the things that I know how to do are just muscle memory. Click, double click. Double click doesn't work for anyone until it works, and then suddenly they forget that they didn't know how to double click. I mean, some people too, shaking hand, trackpads, trackballs, like there's assistive technology options for people who are really gonna have a hard time, but for a lot of people, it's muscle memory. Learn how to click and hold. Learn how to click and drag. Solitaire, everybody wasn't told to play solitaire because it's the funnest card game. Everybody was told to play solitaire because that's how you learn to use a mouse. Secret, tricky. I know, right? I didn't know that for the longest time. So, you know, you don't tell people, like, play solitaire, you'll love it. Or, like, play solitaire, old people love solitaire. You tell them to play to, like, learn to practice their mouse skills and not feel like they're not getting it wrong. Vocabulary, any word people don't know, we write it down. I don't care what the word is. I have a list of vocabulary I think they won't know. And every now and again, we don't get to it, and people are like, what's this? You didn't tell me what a pixel was. I'm like, all right, a pixel is the smallest unit of. But people like feeling like they're learning things, and the vocabulary also helps them use the Google, which is really where I would prefer people would go with future vocabulary questions, but they can't start out there. And also, like I said, books, dummies guides, more information, have those readily available. Not everyone is a learn by doing person. Not everyone is a learn by hearing person. Some people are learned by reading people. Some people are like, go away and think about it and then come back and try it again. And you're going to get all kinds of people, so don't presume. I mean, exercises are good, but you may have a couple students who are just like, I, you know, this doesn't work for me. I'm going to have to think about it. All right. And when things aren't working, this is great, because I would love to just try this on the wireless, but like, it's not my wireless, so I'm trying to not try to fix it. But this is part of what we talk to people about learning what they know and learning what they think, which is important. It's their learning experience. So tell me what happened in your own words. What were you doing when it happened? You know, I've had people who are like, computer's dead. I'm like, what happened? Well, I moved my chair and, oh, is your chair near the power outlet? Hang on a second, you know. But like, people don't know, they have no idea. You know, certain things, like how come I can't ignore the check oil light on my car, but I can't ignore the check engine light. That doesn't make any sense. But one of them you have to turn the car off immediately, and one of them you can drive to the mechanic. I don't know why. They don't know why, you know, things just go off all the time. They certainly don't know why turning it off and turning it on again fixes 90% of everything. It shouldn't work, totally does. But asking people what they were trying to do. Twitter used to have this great tech support page that was like, what did you do? What were you expecting to happen? What happened instead? Because often, you know, people want a linear flowchart, and stuff's just not linear. Sorry, I wish it were, it's not.
But so figuring out what they were expecting can often help you figure out, like, maybe something needs to be described better, maybe something needs to be done different. And my note for myself, that if you see the PDF, I always sort of think, I am the smiling Buddha. Like, my job is to, you know, help people with this, not get angry, not get frustrated. I mean, we've all seen like 8 million pictures of people angry at other people on the internet. One of my favorite has to do with like watching somebody use the scroll bar instead of the scroll wheel on the mouse and getting increasingly angrier and angrier watching the person not scroll and then watching them Google the URL that they have to. I'm a happy person. I'm doing what I love for a job. So, moving on. So like, you know when my car didn't start? Not really, I don't really know that much about cars, but I know it's either gas or the battery or the spark thing not happening. It's one of those. Let's move on. But I can use that information to maybe help troubleshoot myself, and then, or the broker. There's an auto shop at my school where I do computers, and it's changed my life, having a mechanic who is a nice, friendly person. Because all these things that people are with computers, I am with my automobile. Like, I don't know, it just made a noise, and now I'm frightened, and my car does like crazy stuff. It stopped working for no reason. Oh, well, your shifter cable broke. Why did that happen? I don't know. But that's the thing. Why did it happen? Doesn't matter why my shifter cable broke at all. Unless I did a thing to break it, which I was pretty sure I did. People oftentimes want to talk to me. Why would you do this to me? Like, it doesn't matter. It's not mad at you. It doesn't matter. And so cross-pollination, like I said, air, spark, gas. Are we looking at a hardware problem? Is something physically wrong? Did you kick the cord out from under? Is it a software problem? Students don't know the difference between hardware and software. It's a teaching moment to kind of explain, well, the computer has instructions, it teaches it how to do a thing, so it may be that it was expecting you to do a thing, you did a different thing, whatever. Wetware problem? People familiar with this acronym? Michael is. We call this, problem exists between keyboard and chair. You never say this out loud to people, but it is kind of a way that you can be like, they hit the window off the side and they didn't know they hit it, so we had to unhide it for a while. But a wetware problem, humans make mistakes. I do the same thing, actually, all the time. Gremlins. There's no such actual thing as gremlins, but sometimes software things combine, you get your computer, my favorite thing on this handout, let's see. I just wanted to read it out loud. By the time they ask you for help, they've probably tried several things. As a result, their computer might be in a strange state. This is normal. But, you know, weird things happen. Ask them to turn it off, turn it on again, see if that helps. You know, it's not gremlins. I really don't like the computer has issues people, because the computer doesn't have issues. It's a robot. It doesn't care. It doesn't care about you. It's not helping you when things are working, but it's not fighting you when things aren't working. It's just a giant calculator we need to learn to talk to. That's all. So, wrapping up. You've all heard him. The teaching to fish thing, we've all heard that ultimately teaching them how to do this for themselves, which is the goal, right? The goal is they do it themselves, not that they always need to come to the library, though we're happy for them to come to the library a lot in the near future. But what we want is people to have their own happy relationships with technology. And part of that is going to be teaching them how to get answers when you're not around. Part of this is not going to their home, not giving them your phone number, and not having them email you on the weekends if that's not what you want. If it is what you want, perfect. I give most of my students my email and get all this wrong. One of the things that's involved in that is knowing where the other people are who are solving their own problems on the internet, which I cannot stress enough. Everything that you can get on a computer has a forum dedicated to people talking about it on the internet. I work with Open Library a lot, which is a project of the Internet Archive, and they use Adobe Digital Editions as their digital rights management nonsense. And it throws up error messages that make absolutely no sense to me whatsoever. And so when I'm trying to help people with them, I'll Google some stuff. But if we still can't get a resolution, I'm like, I think you need to ask this question on the Adobe Digital Editions forum. That's where people talk about Adobe Digital Editions, and they can help you with your specific instances outside of my thing. Similarly, if you've got a Mac and it's still under warranty, call the people at Apple. They are friendly, and they will help you. Windows, they're friendly, and they're friendly sometimes. So, whatever. They may sometimes be helpful. I have not found them as helpful. But that's fine. The good news is there are people. I had a problem with a scanner. The other day, I was trying to help my friend with the scanner, and we spent 20 minutes, like, installing the drivers, uninstalling the drivers, blah, blah. Finally, I was like, I don't know what's wrong with this. We'll call tech support. Tech support was like a guy named Bob in the Midwest who just answers the phone, like, you know, such and such scanners. I'm like, hi, are you tech support? Yep. And I talked him through what I did, but Bob knew enough to know that my scanner was, in fact, broken, which I was not sure about, and so he explained for us how to do a refund or whatever. I think people believe in their minds that tech support is like calling the police or something with all the attendant, that would make me uncomfortable. You know, your neighbors are going to know you called tech support. But really, that's what I do when I get stuck, either calling tech support or going to forums on the internet. Not great for novice users, but you can show them how to Google an error message, for example, or how to do that kind of stuff so that in the future they may be able to help themselves. And if all you knew about computers and the internet was what other people told you and what you wrote on the paper, you'd be really a little bamboozled too. And I think of a lot of what we're doing is sort of the unbamboozling. And so asking ourselves, are we solving people's real problems and are we helping? Which are the two things we really want to be doing. Finding ways to evaluate this, and basically our job entirely is helping people get better information, better experiences. Sometimes all you want is for someone to have a decent experience with the computer and walk out feeling like, well, that wasn't awful. And better help than they would be getting on their own. And so you don't have to be a computer genius to be able to do this. And in fact, sometimes it helps if you are. So wrapping up with one of my favorite internet cartoons. It's like a joke. And I think this is hilarious. But when I unpack it, the reason I think this is hilarious is because I have a whole bunch of cultural knowledge that makes this picture funny. I've got to know that there's a bear. He was on the Muppet Show. He tells funny jokes. Like, that's who the bear is. I've got to know what Facebook is. That's helpful. And I need to understand that they had an IPO, like a public offering of stock, and the joke, of course, hinges on the fact that going public has two meanings, one of which is the stock and one of which is making all your public stuff available because they're bad with privacy. So all of those things combined turn this into a joke that you don't even understand if you're a person who's not kind of shifted over into that culture. And so it's not that I think everybody needs to be on the internet so that they understand my jokes, although that would help. But one of the things that we're finding is that people are moving forward towards tech culture, whether they want to or not, whether they're being led by us, other people, or pushed, kicking and screaming, by institutions. And the shift isn't really that simple. And it's not that quick. Like, I really thought we'd all have email by now, and I'm surprised. But we're getting better and better at facing it with confidence and good humor, if nothing else. And, you know, us are taking and our communities. So thank you for listening. I talked 5 minutes into lunch. I apologize. This handout is worth getting and reading, and if we get the internet, you're welcome to look up my slides, and you can get me on Twitter at Jessamyn. And I'll be around all day.